Good afternoon and welcome to an hour by the cross here at Emmanuel Church in Bridlington. Welcome to those of you that are gathered here in the church today and to those of you that are joining with us online as well. This will be very different to a normal church service. It's more a time for us to come together to reflect and to pray and to remember what Christ has done for us on the cross. And what we'll be doing through that is we're going to be watching a number of videos of items that have been on the news from the past year, and we're going to use those to guide us through the story of Christ's final hours, to help us put some context in our lives into what Jesus went through. There's going to be some songs as part of that as well. And what I'll encourage you to do is to just pray and to reflect as you see fit. It's not going to be guided in any way. We're not going to have lots of prayers and liturgy today. It's just going to be a time for you to sit and dwell in the presence of God and to lift up to him the things on your own hearts, the things on the hearts of your community, and the things of our world as well, and to put them beneath the arms of the crucified Christ. And as we do this today, as we go through this on this quite somber day, isn't it, Good Friday, I want us to understand that the suffering of Christ on the cross shows that he understands our human suffering that we're going through now. Richard is going to start off with a song, and then there's going to be a number of Bible readings, but I won't be coming up now until the end. So I hope you find this hour by the cross helpful today.
Thank you. Today's reading is taken from John 19, verse 1 to 3 and 16 to 17. Jesus is sentenced to death. Then Pilate had Jesus flogged with a lead-tipped whip. The soldiers wove a crown of thorns and put it on his head, and they put a purple robe on him. "Hail, King of the Jews," they mocked as they slapped him across the face. Then Pilate turned Jesus over to be crucified. So they took Jesus away, carrying the cross by himself. He went to the place called Place of the Skull in Hebrew, which means Golgotha.
Just come out of the supermarket. There's no fruit and veg. I had a little cry in there. I'm a critical care nurse. I've just finished 48 hours of work. I just wanted to get some stuff in for the next 48 hours. There's no fruit, there's no vegetables. I just don't know how I'm supposed to stay healthy. And those people, when people are just stripping the shelves of basic foods. You just need to stop it. Because it's people like me that are going to be looking after you when you're at your lowest. Just stop it. Please.
The readings, Matthew 27, verses 31 and 32. After they had mocked him, they took off his robe and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him away to crucify him. As they were going out, they met a man from Cyrene named Simon, and they forced him to carry the cross.
It's been acknowledged by government and other public bodies that the pandemic has hit vulnerable groups and those living in deprived areas the hardest. Official figures for England show that the overall death rate between April and June this year in the poorest areas was nearly double that of the least deprived. The government says it is committed to reducing deprivation and has spent over £100 billion in welfare support this year, and that they are ensuring that councils have the appropriate resources. Our special correspondent Ed Thomas has spent time in Burnley and reports now on some of those trying to cope there with unemployment and with mental health issues.
I love the poor because I know I'm the poor. And as long as I breathe, I'll serve the poor.
No need to push, there's plenty.
You see, all these people, they have children. Hungry children.
We need social distancing or we're going to get in trouble.
It's hard to keep your distance when you're cold and hungry.
Politicians say that it was 11, this coronavirus. It's a lie, because if you're poor, you've got no chance.
There's tuna, pasta, bacon, all sorts in here.
It's really hard to get food for myself because I've got much money only. and I can't go out anywhere.
A couple of days' food is mean everything to us.
We'll have no fighting.
Every time you get any money, it disappears as fast as you've got it. With the coronavirus as well, with a reduction in wages, it's not easy to cope.
So this means you can eat? Today.
Yes, yeah, you can eat and it helps out wherever you're stuck.
I think they've all got chocolate here, brother.
And all this is laid on by Pastor Mick.
The knee's massive, absolutely colossal. This is the church I represent.
The level of need here in Burnley at the moment is, I think, unprecedented. And it's upsetting.
We got some bread as well, yeah?
For too many, the legacy of coronavirus is not only sickness, but desperation.
Visiting a family who had no carpet, had no settee, who had no gas, had no electric, they had no food. That broke my heart because nobody cared for them. They fell through the crack. Pot noodles, that kind of stuff, all right.
I go into houses and I sometimes have children ripping the bags open to get at the food as I'm carrying them to the door. And it's not all right, though. That's not all right. And it wasn't as bad as that before the virus.
The biggest part of coronavirus has been the loneliness.
Most days, Pastor Mick helps people like Viv. She's 55.
I keep trying to force myself to eat. I'd stop eating for about a week. I just ended up collapsing on my bathroom floor.
Living in isolation became too much.
It's just like brought it all back. I've lost my husband, I've buried two of my babies. I give birth to them, all I wanted them to do was cry and they didn't cry. Yeah. No mother has to go through that.
The coronavirus brought all this.
Yeah, it's brought every moment back to me.
When you collapsed, what went through your mind?
Just let me go, let me, you know. My number must be up. I thought my time were up.
And Pastor Mick says he's hearing more and more of these stories.
We're trying to fetch a bit of hope to people's lives.
The unfairness of health deprivation.
I feel angry because people aren't listening.
What has coronavirus meant for your care?
It stopped it. I'm supposed to have a blood test done once a month for my cancer count. Nobody's been and done it. 6 months. I don't want to be a drain on the system that's already dying, because I'm already dying.
We can't do nothing to help. We've just got to sit back and watch it.
There's not many people lose a child, and there's even less that lose two.
The first lady of our food bank came and she broke down. Her daughter had killed herself.
We pray. Jesus. Amen.
You have to try and find words.
Without their support, what would have happened to you?
Me, I'd probably be where my daughter is now. Up there. I probably would have took me on that if it weren't for them.
Together, they're the hope for thousands through this crisis.
Do you know, it's... You carry people's burdens. You try to tell them that it's all right. This is so upsetting.
That was Father Alex Frost ending that report there by our special correspondent, Ed Thomas.
The reading is Luke 23, verses 27 to 31. A large number of people followed him, including women who mourned and wailed for him. Jesus turned and said to them, "Daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me, weep for yourselves and your children. For the time will come when you will say, 'Blessed are the childless women, the wombs that never bore, and the breasts that never nursed.' Then they will say to the mountains, 'Fall on us,' and to the hills, 'Cover us.' For if people do these things when the tree is green, what will happen when it's dry?"
This was taken from a post on Facebook by Father Brian Fitzpatrick of the Seago Parish in Ireland on the 20th of January this year. After our Mass for frontline staff today, I was called to Craigavon Hospital to anoint someone near the end of life with COVID-19. On the ward, I was shown to the bed where the curtains were pulled round. Behind the curtains were four people with the patient, all in full PPE, gowns, masks, visors, helmets, gloves, whom I presumed were family members as one was in tears. Others were holding the patient's hand or head, and someone was praying aloud but softly. As I took my place beside the bed, the names on the visors told me that these were not the patient's family, but the young nurses and doctors. They were the ones comforting him, weeping for him, praying with him. These are our frontline staff. They are giving everything in service for us and our family members, and I will never forget that touching sight and beautiful experience as long as I live. God bless them, uphold them, protect them, and reward them.
Mark 15, 22 to 32. They brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. Then they offered him wine mixed with myrrh, but he did not take it. And they crucified him. Dividing up his clothes, they cast lots to see what each would get. It was 9 in the morning when they crucified him. The written notice of the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." They crucified 2 rebels with him, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by hurled insults at him, shaking their heads and saying, "So, you who are going to destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, come down from the cross and save yourself." In the same way, the chief priests and the teachers of the law mocked him among themselves. "He saved others," they said, "but he can't save himself. Let this Messiah, this King of Israel, come down now from the cross, that we may see and believe." Those crucified with him also heaped insults on him.
The fifth Bible reading is Matthew chapter 27, verses 45 to 56. From noon until 3 in the afternoon, darkness came over all the land. About 3 in the afternoon, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" When some of those standing there heard this, they said, "He's calling Elijah." Immediately, one of them ran and got a sponge. He filled it with wine vinegar, put it on a staff, and offered it to Jesus to drink. The rest said, "Now leave him alone. Let's see if Elijah comes to save him." And when Jesus had cried out again in a loud voice, he gave up his spirit. At that moment, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook, the rocks split, and the tombs broke open. The bodies of many holy people who had died were raised to life. They came out of the tombs after Jesus' resurrection and went into the holy city and appeared to many people. When the centurion and those with him who were guarding Jesus saw the earthquake and all that had happened, they were terrified and exclaimed, "Surely he was the Son of God." Many women there, watching from a distance, they had followed Jesus to Galilee, from Galilee, to care for his needs. Among them were Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James and Joseph, and the mother of Zebedee's sons.
Nine days ago, my son had symptoms, had fever and a cough, phoned 111 and they said, "Isolate yourself," which he did. He was really poorly. He didn't get any worse, but he didn't get any better for some time, up to day seven. By day seven, he just started to come round a little bit. He was eating a little bit and he got up and went to the toilet. So he was improving then. That was day seven. Unfortunately, on day seven, he suddenly got really bad in the afternoon, and my daughter-in-law phoned the ambulance to come. They came within 10 minutes, but in that 10 minutes, he just collapsed and died.
Oh, Maureen,
now,
I'm so sorry.
She wants to know, how safe is it for her to go in the bedroom? She won't go in because she said it's so full of virus in there.
Yeah.
How long do you have to wait before you feel that it's safe?
Look, Maureen, I'm so sad. I could come and give you a hug if I could.
Oh, no,
I'm so
that's
sorry.
That's exactly what I need. I've lost my son,
yeah,
and my family,
yeah,
can't come near me.
I feel your pain. I would give you a big hug if I could. It's so sad. It really is. You bring tears to my eyes. I'm sorry.
I know. The doctor is upset.
The sixth Bible reading is taken from Luke chapter 23, verses 50 to 56. Now there was a man named Joseph, a member of the council, a good and upright man, who had not consented to their decision and action. He came from the Judean town of Arimathea, and he himself was waiting for the kingdom of God. Going to Pilate, he asked for Jesus' body. Then he took it down, wrapped it in a linen cloth, and placed it in a tomb cut in the rock, one in which no one had yet been laid. It was preparation day, and the Sabbath was about to begin. The women who had come with Jesus from Galilee followed Joseph and saw the tomb and how his body was laid in it. Then they went home and prepared spices and perfumes, but they rested on the Sabbath in obedience to the commandment.
The Rombero family have gathered to bury their 90-year-old mother, who died of coronavirus in a care home 2 weeks ago. They say she would have wanted a big funeral with all her family and flowers. But under the lockdown, large gatherings are prohibited.
I think it's like war, no?
Every 10 minutes, another hearse arrives. There isn't much time for goodbyes. Each coffin is wrapped in plastic to protect the living. They try, but it's difficult to give the dead the dignity they deserve in a pandemic. The priest flicked holy water at the end of the service, and then it's over. And another one begins.
El número habitual era 10, 12 personas, pero con esta situación es muy agravante, sube el número según la capacidad entre 25 a 30 personas.
Even grieving here has to be done quickly and without much support. Only three family members are allowed to attend. They wear gloves and face masks for their protection. Some live stream the short service so other relatives can pay their respects. In a Catholic country, though, where family is everything, it is painfully not enough.
We're watching another funeral take place now. They are continuous. And it's heartbreaking, but this is the reality of what life is like here now. Even the most intimate of acts, burying one's loved ones, is taking place under severe restrictions. Not all the family can attend, only a few members can come. They're wearing protective clothing and they're having to stand apart to prevent, to limit the spread of the coronavirus.
In another church, across Madrid, people are storing the ashes of their loved ones because there is a huge backlog of services that need to be carried out. Spain's coping, but it's not easy adjusting to a new way of being where death is everywhere. Father Ignacio Andreo says people need the church more than ever in these dark times.
Es una cosa que es la puerta abierta que pueden venir cuando se acercan, pero también desenterrar el grupo de WhatsApp. Que ha sido, es algo, verdad, que nos agobia a todos los grupos de WhatsApp y hay que coger el teléfono, llamar o hacer una videollamada y que te vea la cara y que el otro te escuche. Y decirle a mucha gente, incluso antiguos, de antiguas parroquias por las que he estado, llamarles y decirles, pues me acuerdo de ti, rezo por ti.
He is now harnessing the power of the internet to minister to his congregation to meet social distancing rules. Daily services are live streamed to the faithful in their living rooms. It's not the same, but it does allow people to connect and hope for better times. Alex Rossi, Sky News, Madrid.
A
crown of thorns placed on his head. He knew that he would soon be dead. He said, "Did you forget me, Father? Did you?" They nailed him to a wooden cross. Soon all the world would feel the loss of Christ the King before his hallelujah. 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 He hung his head and prepared to die, then lifted his face up to the sky, said, "I am coming home now, Father, to you." A reed which held his final sip was gently lifted to his lips. He drank his last and gave his soul to glory. Used his sword to pierce the body of our Lord, said, "Truly this was Jesus Christ, our Savior." He looked with fear upon his sword, then turned to face his Christ and Lord, fell to his knees, crying, took from his head the thorny crown and wrapped him in a linen gown, then laid him down to rest inside the tomb. The holes in his hands, his feet inside, now in our hearts we know he died to save us from ourselves.
As the pandemic of coronavirus claims more lives around the world, the people of the United Kingdom are now being advised to make drastic changes.
The virus is indiscriminate.
When things go wrong, as they sometimes will.
Sight of airports unused.
When the road you're trudging seems all uphill.
I think I'm too late.
When the funds are low but the debts are high. And you want to smile, but you have to sigh.
I didn't take this virus seriously until it's all this.
When care is pressing you down a bit.
We want to need you.
Rest if you must, but don't you quit. Life is strange with its twists and turns, as every one of us sometimes learns.
Here we are again, of course, with no audience.
And many failures turn about, or we might have won had we stuck it out.
Come on, little man. It's going to be all right.
I don't mind. My mind is free. I can be anywhere.
Don't give up, though the pace seems slow.
Thank you for staying at home.
You may succeed with another blow. Success is failure turned inside out.
Keep it up, man, you're doing very well.
The silver tin of the clouds of doubt.
What this has done is bring communities together.
And you can never tell how close you are.
This is a unique moment.
It may be near, when it seems so far.
Everything's okay.
So stick to the fight when your heart is hit.
What I thought?
It's when things seem worst that you must not quit.
Poem at the end there that we saw, read by Idris Elba, was written by John Greenleaf Whittier, who also wrote the hymn, Dear Lord and Father of Mankind. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you that you sent your Son into this world to die for us, to die for all those that we have seen today in these videos, to die to the many, to die for the many thousands that have lost their lives or had their lives impacted by COVID. We thank you, Lord, that you died for us all. And we remember the sacrifice that you have made. A sacrifice that brings us hope in the darkest of times. Be with us for the remainder of this day as we dwell with you at the cross, but we prepare for the joy of Easter. In Jesus' name, amen. I'd like to invite you to stand, and we will be hearing from the song, I Stand Amazed at the Presence of Jesus the Nazarene.
Singing, how much
Say the grace together. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, evermore. Amen.